everybody. Let's see, let's turn this around.
So, yeah, let's just get it going here. You're live, we're building an audience for you. Okay, so a couple quick things. If anyone needs a restroom, you go down there and through the back corner. A lot of the doors here are like hiding in the wall, so you just push your way through the back corner. There's men's and ladies' rooms back there.
Okay.
And let's see. Let me give a little introduction of where we. Well, this will be part of what I talk about. So, hi everybody, Chris Kostelnick here. First Facebook live feed. It's funny. I just made this post on Facebook a couple weeks ago. How do I turn off the thing that constantly is telling me that people are going live on Facebook? And then it turned into this whole thread on my Facebook page, so it's kind of ironic I'm doing one now, but duty calls, you know. Since it is our two-time Stir Labs Badwater 135 champion, who just did something incredible. Yes. So that's why we're here at the Explorers Club. So we're gonna start in just a couple minutes. All right.
Jeffrey says, hey.
Let me give you an introduction of the club first, which I was going to read off my phone, but I can't do that, so I'll just do it off the top of my head. So, I don't need a microphone. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Explorers Club. This is our club headquarters, World Center for Exploration, and our club was founded in 1904, and we are an international organization of dedicated to the scientific exploration of the world, which basically means people who are doing things that have never been done, going places that have never been gone to, learning things that have never been learned, and then disseminating that information in a scientific manner. This is the Clark Room, and we have quite a few of our club flags on the wall. So if you're a member of the club, which I've been a member since 1998, I work in archaeology primarily. If you're a member of the club, you can apply to the flag committee to request to take a club flag on an expedition that you're leading or joining. And so these are just a handful of the many flags that we have that have been all over the world and into space. And so each of the flags is numbered, and we track the history of each flag and which expeditions it's been on. And then some of them get retired because they are of such huge historic significance that we don't want to risk them being damaged or lost somewhere out in the wild, and so some of them will end up on display here. For example, the one over there on that wall went with Hillary and Norgay to the top of Mount Everest, and then it also went in just a few years back with James Cameron to Challenger Deep, which is the deepest point in the ocean. It's 35,000 feet below sea level. So that flag has been to the highest and lowest points of the planet. This flag here went on the Kon-Tiki raft with Thor Heyerdahl and his Norwegian compatriots when they sailed across the Pacific from South America to the South Pacific. It was 48, if I remember correctly. And so that was the flag that went with the Kon-Tiki expedition. Some of my personal favorites are these. The very small flags were flown with NASA programs, Apollo, and they're small because the amount of weight going into space is a huge factor in terms of liftoff and getting through the atmosphere. But this one here that's sealed in the bag is a full-size flag. It was intended to fly on the surface of the moon with Apollo 13, which I'm sure you all know, if not from history, then from the excellent movie. That Apollo 13, they weren't able to land on the moon. In fact, they were lucky to get back on Earth, come back to Earth. So here's the letter that from Jim Lovell apologizing that the flag didn't make it to the surface of the moon. The other one I'll mention is an earlier prototype flag over here. This one was carried by Roy Chapman Andrews to the Gobi Desert in 1925. You might not have heard of Roy Chapman Andrews, but he's the person that is universally considered the person upon which Indiana Jones was based. And so that, and then up here, this is one of the sledges that went to the North Pole in 1909 with Peary and his team, first people to reach the North Pole. And so that's one of the sledges that went there. So anyway, I'm happy that I'm a member of the club so that I could arrange to make it available for all of you to be here to celebrate Pete and his support team and their amazing accomplishment. So welcome to the club, and thank you for letting me be your host. And I had one thing I wanted to read, which is I got in touch with Allison Venti, who's now Allison Allen, this week. I actually brought her here to the club earlier this year, just before they moved out to Barbados, because I'd like to sponsor her and her husband to be members of the club. And I asked if there was any way we could bring her up, but there was to be here for Pete and his arrival. And it wouldn't work with her schedule, but she did send me a statement to read to Pete, and so I have that. So this is from our also two-time Badwater 135 champion, Allison Venti, now Allison Allen. Pete is a tremendous athlete. I had the pleasure of meeting him at Badwater in 2014, both our rookie year. My impression of him was a composed, humble, focused, and determined athlete. 2 years later, and two Badwater championships and course record later, my impression of him is unaltered. He is still the same humble, focused, and determined athlete. Pete is methodical. Pete's methodical and meticulous training is truly inspiring. We share a common joy for high weekly mileage. He told me once my high mileage training him inspired him to step it up between 2014 and 15. He said, quote, knowing there was someone out there who had success from putting in the miles with such discipline really got me excited about going into 2015 and what I could do, end quote. He has now taken that to an entirely new level with his Transamerica run. Pete inspires us all to step out of our comfort zone and explore what lies outside the boundaries of normal and familiar. Though it's hard to fully grasp the magnitude of his accomplishment here, Pete's achievement serves as a testimony to his dedication, discipline, commitment, and determination. His feat will continue to inspire long after Pete takes his final steps in New York City. So congratulations, Pete. That's for you. Yay! You guys for your grand book.
That's so cool.
And at this point, I think we just want to bring Pete up. And do you want to sit or stand?
I can stand.
Okay, yeah. Great. All right, there she goes. See,
this is
yeah. So, why don't you stand here, Pete? I'll hide behind the podium. So, Pete, congratulations.
Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome. Fantastic run. So, back before you were embarking upon this, I said to Tracy I would fly out if you made it, And I did say if, because to be honest, just historically speaking, since it's been 36 years and a lot of very accomplished athletes have attempted this feat and not made it, or didn't finish, or were slower, you know, I thought the odds were stacked against you, so I really salute you even more, because a record that stands for 36 years is a huge deal. So before we get to, you know, meeting Frank at the steps yesterday, the former record holder, let's go back to the beginning. Tell us a little bit about, you know, how did you get this idea? Do you remember when you first thought, oh, I want to run across America?
Yeah, I really didn't know anything about running across America until...
I'll stand over here so you're running this way.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it was 2011, I did the Pikes Peak Marathon, and actually my now wife, Nikki, was with me at the race, and we were at the pre-race briefing, and they said this guy named Marshall Ulrich was going to talk, so I stayed around. I thought, you know, they're like, oh, he's been to the top of Everest, he's done other crazy things, and then, so we stayed around, and I sat in the front row and listened to him talk about some of his crazy adventures, and, you know, one of the biggest was running across America in 2008, and so from there I read his book. I got a chance to meet him and his wife, and I read his book and immediately became like obsessed with that idea. Not that I wanted to really do it myself, but I just really loved reading about his adventures and then Charlie Engel's adventures. And
had you run an ultra marathon yet?
I had run one 40-mile road ultra marathon, but nothing really further than that at the time. So it wasn't really anything that I, you know, thought I was going to do. Although my wife Nikki said, "Oh, you're probably going to do something like that someday." When I talked to Marshall and Heather there at the race, and I thought, "No, there's no way I'll do that." But that was where I got the initial idea, and then over these last 5 years, I've gotten more into running, and you know what was originally, or I guess more into ultra running, I should say. And you know what was really just kind of something that I loved reading about at the time started to become more and more a reality as I started doing longer races, 100 milers, doing the Stirlab's Badwater 135 now 3 times. And it was really last year when I took first place that I thought, well, maybe, you know, instead of just doing a run across the country someday, you know, for fun, maybe I'll take a little bit of the fun out and actually go for the record. Because I love reading about the history of the record, like you mentioned, 36 years. You know, things like that really inspire me, or, you know, it's just, I guess, just the allure of something that's so challenging and that so much has to go right, that if it does go right, you know, it's just...
The odds are so stacked against you.
So, you know, like, it's like winning the lottery. Like, your chances are so slim that, you know, if you succeed, you know, even though you didn't really do anything to earn it, you know...
Hey, those $2, you know, could have bought half a coffee.
That's right. So you know, if you can make it work and you can survive, I think that makes it all the sweeter with all the bitter things that can happen. So I think, you know, over the years, just getting into ultra running more and reading about that story and that initial inspiration and the journey and all the towns along the way that Marshall and Charlie ran through, and then all of the people along the way as well, was something that, you know, sounded like something I wanted to do. And when I thought I could go for the record, it was, you know, a no-brainer that I was going to do it.
So you really thought about going for the record after you won the Badwater 135 last year in 2015. Mm-hmm. And then you came back and you went even faster. You won again this year and also broke the record, which had stood for 9 years. Now, at that point, were you already committed to going across America? So you were?
Yep. Yeah. And actually...
when did you make that total commitment? Okay, I'm going for it this 2016.
I officially told everyone about it in June, but I think it was probably in the springtime, sometime around March or April, that Charlie Engel, who was an amazing mentor for me on this run, introduced me to Chuck and Dean and
support crew members.
Yep. That really kind of really put it into motion, something that was, you know, not just a thought of doing it, but really something that was coming into play. And then later on, also Tracy and I got in contact once I said that I wanted to do this to a larger audience. She graciously lent her support and joined the team. And then actually at Badwater this year, Cinder put out a message on Facebook to the Badwater runners and
About joining a crew?
No, just about giving a massage at the race.
Oh, okay.
And so the pre-race massage. So I said, "Heck, I'll take one." And you know,
best hands there are to work on a body.
Yeah.
At least in a legal manner. So yeah.
And
so that's when you met?
Yeah, and okay. Like, I think we were Facebook friends, but we weren't really like close acquaintances at that time.
You mean Facebook friends aren't the same as real friends?
So she was giving me a pre-race massage, and I told her about this crazy transcon idea, and that I had, you know, a team of three, and that, you know, there were still a lot of unknowns. And I was amazed because she said, "Sign me up," and I said, "Okay, let's do this." And so yeah, everyone was kind of a Badwater connection, because I wouldn't have met Chuck and Dean if it weren't for meeting Charlie at Badwater Cape Fear, and then Also, Tracy through Badwater.
So you just met Charlie at Badwater Cape here this year?
2015.
Or 2015, yeah.
And then Tracy, also another Badwater connection, and Cinder at Badwater this year at the 135. So
basically, Badwater gets all the credit for what you've done.
That's right.
So tell us then, so really, it was those people not only agreeing to support you, but, you know, having faith in you, then you were really locked in. And you know, did your training for the Badwater 135 vary at all because you knew it was going to be a stepping stone to running across America?
No, it was really just, you know, as many miles as I could squeeze in. I mean, I was going completely down the Ali Venti training method, and that was to put in as many, if I could get 200 mile training weeks in, I would put them in where they were, the time was available, and it was definitely very helpful getting ready for the Transcon as well.
So let's get you to San Francisco and on your way. I noticed at the finish line yesterday, you'd fallen down yesterday, and you fell down the first day of the race. So you left San Francisco, and you actually headed south. I know Charlie and Marshall somehow ran across the Bay Bridge. I don't know how they pulled that off. They obviously have better connections. So you actually embarked towards the East Coast by running south for how far?
Yeah, it was kind of crazy because I was actually going to take the Golden Gate Bridge.
Oh, you were going to go north out of San
Francisco? Originally, yeah. But then all because we had to just deviate a little bit of Utah, we had to go slightly south further in Utah with some restricted roads. And that had a whiplash effect all the way from Utah back to the start, mm-hmm. where it made just a slightly more sense to go south. Down along the bay and then across the
Dunbarton Bridge. Yeah, that's the only bridge that has a pedestrian other than the Golden Gate. Yeah.
Yeah, and then that put us through Yosemite rather than going up closer to Tahoe. We got further east into California.
Plus, you wanted to go through California's second best national park.
That's right.
Yeah. All right. So then you pretty much, did you lock into your kind of daily schedule right on day one?
No, I did a lot.
Tell us about that.
No, I was silly. So day one was my 29th birthday. So I thought it would be cute. Actually, I'd whispered to a couple people that I wanted to do 87 miles on the first day, because, which is ironically what I did in the last day. But I was whispering to just a few people, okay, well, I'm going to go out and do 87 miles. I want to make a big splash. And
because you were born in 1987.
I was born in 1987, and then I was 29, so 29 times 3 is 87. And I thought,
wow,
just a real cute way to put up a big number and make everybody aware that this crazy guy's run across the country. But
that 3 in there, I think we need to make this into a triathlon, and let's go for a bike and a run tomorrow.
Right,
so.
Yeah.
All right, so you wanted to do 87 the first day, and you did that?
81.
So you failed, in other words. Okay, yeah. All right.
Failed day one. So then day two, you know, it was kind of just like, okay, we're just going to run until we say we're done. And we didn't really have a plan for how many miles I was going to do. So ended up doing about 80 miles again on the second day. And that's the day where there's a picture of me laying down. Like, I had just literally spiked my water bottle and was laying down face down on the...
What did you put in your water bottle? Was it scotch, whiskey?
No. You know, I don't know. Okay. Chuck and Dean might really answer that.
Okay.
But, I think it was right when Chuck said, you know, there was still about one more mile to go up this really steep incline on day two, and I was just exhausted. And it, just looking back on that, it was just silly because I was basically putting myself to the point of exhaustion every day one and day two. And day three in Yosemite, same thing. I did somewhere in the mid-70s for mileage, and that included starting the day at around 2,000 feet elevation and ending the day over 9,000 feet.
Now, were you doing, I know later in the run you were breaking it into basically two runs a day, like a 40 mm-hmm. and a 30. So did you do that in the beginning?
Early on, I was doing three.
Three runs.
Like a marathon to 50K twice, and then like a shorter 10 to 15 mile run on top of that. But then I was noticing that, you know, just starting up after a break was really tough. So mm-hmm. if I could narrow it down to two segments rather than one, it would just mean less, I guess, starting the engine back up. So
So when did you lock into that formula and kind of stick to it?
Mostly, so I eventually things got really bad, and I had to take a day off on day 7 with some tendonitis issues, and I was also under the weather. So then starting on day 8, we really started to do the 2 segments and really focus on getting to ride at as close to 70 miles as possible. And that's where the routine really started.
So let's back up to what you just mentioned, which is the break you took on day 7, because looking back on it, I think that was a genius move for you because, in my lifetime of experience with ultra endurance sports, people get injured or they have something coming on and then it just gets more and more debilitating and then they slow down and maybe don't finish. So it seems like that was really a great move. Your crew might have been surprised and other fans and stuff. I don't know if other Transamerica runners have taken days off like that, if they're really going for a time, but did that feel weird to just sit around all day?
Yeah, it did. Yeah, it was very frustrating because, you know, I wanted to get out. Obviously, I was trying to start out heavy on the mileage the first few days, but then to have a setback like that. But it was also, I was just in such a bad place with the tendonitis. Whenever, you know, I couldn't even maintain like a 10-minute mile going downhill.
Wow.
And so it was just, I would shout sometimes in pain because it was just not fun.
So, and so you were able to recover substantially in one day of rest.
Yeah, it did. It did help a lot.
Well, your body didn't know what that was. You probably run 7 days a week all the time anyway.
Right,
so
yeah,
it was.
Yeah. The day off really helped. I had some medication for some of the inflammation, and that really helped as well. And then also
cinder.
Yes. Exactly. Yeah.
Yep.
And not climbing Yosemite anymore definitely helped as well.
Yeah. So then you locked into your schedule and pretty much kept that all the way after that point.
Yeah. Really. I mean, we were pretty much right at about 70 to 75 miles a day every single day from there on. I think there was maybe one day where I hit 77, and then the very last day, the final push at 87 miles, but other than that, it was very, very consistent. Which,
so you just walk us through that. So you'd start your, you'd get up at what time?
I get up at 3:30, and then out the door by 4.
Okay.
And then usually it would take me about 6 to 7 hours to do 40 miles.
Okay, so that's 10, 11 a.m.
Mm-hmm. And I get to the lunch break.
And that would be in the motorhome?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, so the RV would drive up about 40 miles wherever there's a pull off, and then have lunch, and about 35, 40 minutes later, head back out.
Would you get a massage while you're eating, or?
We would do a stretching. So the first thing in the morning, and then after lunch, we would do Cinder would stretch me out, and then after the day was over, we would do a full like massage.
So then you'd get out, you'd around 11, you'd take your break, and then you'd resume and run 30 miles.
Mm-hmm.
And so when would you usually finish, roughly?
Usually about 5 o'clock in the afternoon. I think the earliest I ever got done was about 4 in the afternoon, and then latest, once we got under the normal schedule, was usually, I usually was done by 6 p.m.
So you were getting 6-8 hours of sleep a night?
Mm-hmm. Yep, usually in bed by 7, and that would give me a good 8-hour window.
And so would the motorhome literally just park at, you know, mile 70 or whatever it is, and you would just do it right there?
Well, I mean, it was amazing how lucky we were, because there were some times, like, I know in Colorado, where it was probably a 45, 50 mile stretch where literally you weren't allowed to park on the side of the road in a national forest, and then literally like half a mile outside the national forest was like mile 72, which was perfect like mileage. But if we were stuck inside the national forest at mile 72, we would have had to stake out, but we never had to stake out the entire run. I was able to run right to the RV every night.
That's fantastic.
And yeah, it was just like from a time perspective is very efficient.
Wow. And then your crew, how'd you guys get along? Did you ever have any meltdowns out there? Did
you? Just a few. That's the thing about this is
none that Pete is aware of.
Right. He doesn't know what was happening out there.
No.
Right.
Yeah.
And we'll never be aware of.
So let's get Pete to New York City, and then we'll bring the crew up to get some of those behind the scenes anecdotes.
Right.
So were you listening to music?
No, never. Yeah, never listened. It was funny because I went through a town, and they were doing like a local 5K in Pennsylvania, I think on Saturday, and they were blasting music, and I ran through the finish line, and they're like, what are you doing? What race hasn't started? And it was just right on the route. I was like, you know, that's like the first time I've heard like legitimately like cranked up music in like 50 days. So
wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, no TV.
I actually, one of my slogans is music is a crutch. And so I like you even more now, Pete. I didn't know it was possible, but so no music. And were you checking your Facebook all the time on your phone while you're running? And
no, I never had my phone with me while running.
Wow. Hold on a minute. This is a bigger deal to go 42 days without a smartphone.
Yeah,
that's bigger than running across America. I think.
I probably spent more time just syncing my phone to Strava than I did on Facebook.
Yeah,
I posted maybe two things on Facebook in the first 40 days.
Yeah.
So,
wow. Okay. So, as you were bearing down on the finish, at some point you decided to push the mileage at the very end, and you said coincidentally it was 87 miles or thereabouts, just like the way you started. So when did you make that decision?
I think actually it was about 10 days out.
Okay, so 10 days from the finish, you thought.
Friday in Indiana, my dad came out, and then also some friends from Iowa came out, and we were actually documenting it that day. And I told my longtime friend Brad, I think, as well that day, is like, you know, I was doing the math just now, and if I take 70 to 72 times 9, that's about, you know, leaves me about 90 to 100 miles and change left over. So I came out to be 87 miles final push, and I thought, okay, so the last day will be a little bit longer, but yeah, it was, I think, about 10 days out Friday a week ago that I made that decision that Monday would be the last day.
Okay, and so what does that mean in practice? Did you skip a break, or did you get up earlier, or how did that last day unfold?
Yeah, so Sunday night, got done around the normal time. Tried to start about an hour earlier on Sunday, but it was kind of a slow-going day anyways, and got to bed around normal time, around 6:30, 7 o'clock, and woke up at 11:30 and headed out at midnight just to make it easy from a timeline perspective, and cranked it out and got it done. I figured if I started at midnight, I could get done by 7 p.m., so rolled in around 5:30 yesterday at the end.
And there was Frank.
Yep.
Frank Giannino, the record holder since 1980. So that was the first time you'd met or mm-hmm. corresponded, or you hadn't even talked on the phone or anything, right?
No.
So
I'd heard a lot of great things about him, and I've read his book, but about his adventure when he broke the record in 1980, but I never had a chance to talk to him, so it was incredible. He was such a nice guy, and his wife, and I look forward to staying in touch with him and maybe even, you know, coming to visit sometime here.
So when you finished at City Hall at the top of the stairs, so you kind of had your Rocky moment there,
yeah,
running up the stairs. And can you even put into words what you were feeling then? I even hesitate to ask, but I'm going to ask anyway.
I was in the morning yesterday. It was really hard getting going, I think, on the less rest, and knowing that I had 87 miles. So I kept telling people in the morning, like, they came out and run, and honestly, the record is what it is. I just want to be done. I'm just sick of putting one foot, like, mentally, I'm just tired of putting one foot in front of the other. But when I got to the end, it was, you know, that's when it really started to sink in, and saw my wife, and I haven't seen her in about 50 days, so I think.
Oh, you never saw her during the run?
No, because I was coming through the Midwest.
Wow.
She was in Europe.
Really?
Just conveniently in Germany in October for work, I guess. I don't know what that's all about, but.
Wow.
So.
I'm glad you could make it.
So
that was probably the coolest part of the whole thing was,
yeah, I think,
seeing your wife there.
Yeah, I took over there for a little bit.
Yeah.
And then seeing my family and close friends that came out.
Yeah, there was a good crowd, and you had a nice swarm running across all the way down Broadway.
Yeah.
And right at rush hour.
Yeah.
And I guess you were just taking the lane up, and Charlie Engel was doing a live Facebook feed, and he was saying at some point he could barely keep up with you, which is pretty amazing when you consider that you were about to finish, And then meanwhile, he's training for this new race we're putting on in China next month, so he should be in pretty good shape right now. Yeah. And so you just really felt the magnetic pull and you just pushed it in. Well, congratulations, and that's just such a fantastic thing. So let's bring the crew people up and hear what they have to contribute before we go eat pizza and drink your favorite beer, which is apparently Coors Light. So,
that's right.
Minutes? All right, so I'm gonna back up a little bit here. Why don't you guys get in a little closer? Get in a little closer. Put the chair right in front of him, of you guys. No, bring him over here so he's right in there. So, yeah, you can. Yes. So,
yeah, there we go.
I was actually hoping you guys would just help bring it to life a little bit, like describe some of the craziest moments and, you know, most insane things happened out there. Like, you know, I heard there was this one sheriff that pulled a shotgun on you guys. No, I'm kidding. You know, what was that like out there? What were some of the big surprises for you or unexpected things that happened? By the way, notice Cinder going right to work, right, with her magic hands, so.
I think the biggest unexpected was the car wreck.
Yes, so tell us about that.
Chuck and I had stopped at a crew point, and we're all
so you were the car that was supporting him directly, or the,
yeah.
The
yeah? Chuck and I were in the crew van, maybe.
Okay, so you would leapfrog, how long were your leapfrogs normally? Like, how often did you see him? 1.5, 2 miles, okay, you pulled over.
And we were short of the stop sign, but off the side of the road, it's kind of a country road. And Chuck had gotten out back and opened the door already, and I was still in the passenger seat. And a truck come and just kind of veered off to the left, and then just immediately corrected back to the right, right into the side of the van.
From the same direction you were headed?
Yeah,
so they came up behind you and,
wow. The vehicle was parked.
Yeah, it was parked,
The other vehicle
veered off the road and ran right into it, and you were all lucky that you'd gotten out of it.
His new nickname is Superman because he dove into the ditch.
You had like a split did you have like a split second that you knew this was happening? And
yeah, I looked back and saw him swerve, and then he come right towards us, and I jumped, and he hit the car. I didn't have time to yell at Dean, and Dean was still in the car.
Oh, you were in the car.
I was in the passenger.
Whoa.
Side.
Okay.
Both cars.
He drove it about 20 feet down the road through the stop sign.
He didn't break.
Wow.
He hit the car.
And then Pete was behind you at this point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So then Pete, you came running along and you saw the car?
Yeah, I was running with a guy named Matt, and neither of us heard it, but it was like in the first mile, and it was just over a little hill, and Chuck came running down the road, and like, Pete, we got hit, and it was
wow.
Because I was like, because I figured Dean was probably in the car, because I mean, it was just the first mile, and usually Chuck and Dean we'll park like a mile up just to kind of see, make sure I'm starting out okay. And so it's very, very, very nerve-wracking there for a little bit.
Lucky for everybody, including the other driver, y'all
the amazing
walked away.
Thing, though, that logistically we recovered so fast from it, because there was a man that had heard about the run who realized that the route was passing by his house. So he got up early that morning with his motorcycle and sidecar and with his dog and goggles. Came out to the start, and this had never happened to us before, that somebody was actually so interested that they actually got up at 2 in the morning and came out to watch Pete start. And so as soon as that happened, Greg jumped on in and turned us over to where we could start supporting Pete like that, like by noon that morning.
Wow.
These guys were, you know, we determined that they were physically okay and everything. We went, Chuck and I went and picked up another car from the rental agency, and just like that, we just got back on track so fast with the help of Greg, who crewed Pete out of the back of his BMW.
If
you saw pictures from that day, you would actually see me crewing in my leopard skin pajamas.
Yes, nice.
Because we had gone back to sleep for a little while before we could move the RV forward when they called, and we didn't even get dressed. I mean, I literally leaped up, drove the RV down there in my leopard skin pajamas, and then got in the Jeep to go crew.
Yeah.
Wow. So
we just had so many miracles like that.
Yeah, the stars were kept aligning.
Every time there was an incident, we just all kind of focused our attention to it and fixed it so fast, and it made it just all so miraculous. And I think that's one of the themes of this, that, you know, everybody here is so talented in what they're capable of.
Yeah.
We took away all of our, you know, differences and just focused on what we could do so well.
Amazing. Senator, quickly, when you were working on his body, just give us a couple of things. Like, what were the main issues on his body that you were helping him work through? Like, what did you discover through your hands and your work on him?
I think mostly trying to keep his hips lined up, because if his hips are lined up, everything is lined up.
Mm-hmm.
But when his hips are out of alignment, then it really does affect everything. And, you know, one of the things that people don't think about is because of the angles of the side
the road,
and
the camber,
how you have to run on those angles, and then, you know, getting on and off and up and down and things like that across driveways and things, people don't think about what that does. And so that, you know, it causes one side to lengthen, the other one to shorten, just depending on what you're doing.
Were you pretty much always running against traffic, Pete?
Yeah.
So then you had your left leg was a little lower all the time.
And so we did a lot of stretch. Really, we did as much stretching as actually massage. A lot of PNF, a lot of just stretching resistance, keeping things just really super lined up, morning, noon, and night. But just really focusing on, and I would kind of feel an area and go, oh, this feels a little sore. And then we would work on that. A lot of lymphatic drainage, just trying to move that swelling that he was having, those issues, out of there. But the one thing I want to say about Pete is that, and I've said this to his family from day one day one to day 45, when you think of how long we were all together in the RV, from the time we got to San Francisco, way before we left, he's probably the kindest, most humble, respectful person. And I mean, I work with a lot of ultra runners, and I've worked with a lot of really famous ultra runners, crewed for them, and I love most everybody I've ever crewed for, but there's nobody I've ever worked with that's more humble or respectful. He's right up there with Marshall when it comes to humility and respect and please and thank you, no matter what I did.
That's fantastic.
And I just don't think you see that in a lot of 29-year-olds anymore. And so I told his mom and dad, there wasn't a day out there that I would not have been proud to say that he was my son.
Nice.
You know, and so I think his parents' family has been amazing. So, and then I just want to say one more thing about the stops. You don't understand the magnitude of what it takes to move a 31-foot RV through incredible countryside. And to literally every day, and this is nothing, this is not me, this is just how it lined up, but to every single day have a stop at the exact place that Pete would ask me. I mean, he would say, we would talk in the morning, I'd say, how far do you want me to go? And he'd go 40, 41, 42. They'd call me or message me and say, okay, Pete's saying 41, you know, for sure. And I would drive to it and there would be a spot. And I mean, it literally was within a half a mile. I don't think we ever had to go more than a half a mile in a day, except the last day in New Jersey. And really, we had to shorten it, not lengthen it. But it just happened. And
that's,
I mean,
fantastic.
We only stayed in 5 RV parks in 42 of the 42 days. We only stayed in 5 RV parks. Other than that, we were always on the side of the road.
And those RV parks happened to be at 70.
Right where you needed them.
But that was, besides just Pete being the miracle of running it, that was the personal miracle for me in this.
Incredible.
Was that literally,
very fortuitous in so many ways.
That, you know, we could do that.
And other people popped up along the way, like Larry here. He tagged along since Ohio doing photography, which is amazing. And let's wrap up because we're going to eat, but I want to bring Pete's parents up and Larry too, and come on up here and just be on the stream for a minute and say hello.
And
yes.
Logistics.
One of the biggest behind the scenes that we haven't shown a lot of light to is when Pete started.
And wife. Yes.
Started this and was working on the route. Ann had volunteered to help me, and you can tell everybody.
And Ann is Pete's.
Sister. So
yes,
you can tell everybody what that initial conversation was like, and then what ultimately became your responsibility.
Well, I just asked Pete, you know, is there anything I can do to help? because I knew this was going to be a big thing. And so he had like kind of three things that he said. He's like, yeah, there are kind of three spots I'm wondering about on the roof that I'm a little unsure of. And so one was about an Indian reservation and one wanted to make sure we could get through there. One was about the bridge in San Francisco, figuring out that. And then the other was some restricted roads that he saw in Utah. So I was trying to figure out those three things and then kind of realized there was a need for a little more information for him and figuring out the route. And so just kind of snowballed from there.
You became the bat cave for the whole expedition.
Yeah. In a good way.
Yes. Apparently it runs in the family.
So. And it worked out so well for me because I teach and I have summers off, so I could kind of do a lot of that work at that time for him. So it was an honor. So.
That's fantastic. Wow. Well, it's a remarkable thing that you all did. And whether you raised Pete or sistered him, and or crewed or massaged or did PR or everything, just an amazing thing that you all did, and congratulations to all of you. And Pete, I'm not going to ask you what's next because I want you to just bask in what you've done. And
I may have had someone convince me to do Badwater again next year, even though it's 9 days after a 24-hour race, so that might be one of the next things.
Is your recovery good enough to do that, Pete? I don't know.
I'm gonna try. So. you might have to start me in the. You might have to put me in the first wave, though.
What's this assumption you're getting in thing? I mean, like, you know, like. We don't take crazy people. Oh, sorry. Not. All right. Yes, Larry. Larry, he's taken 9,734 photos since Ohio, right? No, I made that number up, but plenty. So I'm going to turn off the feed here and let's do a few photos and then we'll have pizza and beer. So everybody, thanks for tuning in. Thanks again to the Explorers Club for letting us host this here. And congratulations, everybody, and thanks for being here. And congrats.